Well, we have a very provocative title today for our message, and that is, Does God Approve of Torture? And if you've heard any of the news this last week, you know that the Senate Intelligence Committee released a report on certain activities that some of our government officials, particularly the people in the CIA, have been processing in the last several years. And some of it wasn't very sweet, but we might ask a question, what do we really mean when we talk about torture? Where torture has been defined as the action or practice of inflicting severe pain on someone as a punishment, or to force them to do or say something, or for the pleasure of the person inflicting the pain. Now, obviously, some people have different interpretations or understandings of that concept of torture. Very different. Some people think, well, you know, you're only torturing someone when you bring them harm that lasts. In other words, if you inflict some pain on them or some discomfort on them, as long as it doesn't leave a lasting effect, that's no longer torture. That's merely enhanced interrogation techniques. You see. And there have been various methods used anciently. The Inquisition was very good about taking a person, for instance, as we see in this picture, a person with their arms strapped high above their head, tied, lifted up, through a system of pulleys, and they would have a weight that would be tied to their legs. And they would hang them like this, and it's very uncomfortable, and then they would have a mechanism whereby they could drop the person suddenly, but they wouldn't let them hit the floor. They would drop them from maybe like 5 feet high down to within 1 foot of the floor, so there's a sudden jerking and stopping. Not a very pleasant thing. You've probably all heard of the rack, one of the most painful of all torture implements, sometimes tearing joints and even whole limbs off of a person. The Iron Maiden needs no explanation. And then, of course, there's just been simply flagellation or whipping of people, pillory, where people would be left, as it is in the top of the picture, just in a position where they couldn't move or do much. And I don't intend to emphasize this, I don't want to glorify this, I don't want to dwell upon this, but I think we understand what we're talking about when we talk about torture. But ancient torture, friends, has been replaced by modern methods to a great degree. Today, there are other things and other ways to torture people. There's waterboarding, walling, sleep deprivation, and many other things, such as rectal hydration and feeding, walling, facial slapping, cramped confinement, stress positions, and many others. In fact, here we see a slide of sleep deprivation, up to 180 hours perhaps without sleeping, most of the time standing between two close walls that prevent the person from sitting. In the Senate intelligence report that came out, and it's downloadable. You can download all 500 plus pages from the internet. It's available free. I think Amazon's already selling it as an ebook, but you can download the PDF free. And it tells us some of these very things, and that I've just mentioned are listed over on the second page, page 32 of the main body of the report. And there it shows it up in a little higher resolution, but you can see face slap, cramped confinement, wall standing, stress position, sleep deprivation, being in a confined area, and then also in part of the first part of the report, as it goes on over, we have some more things that are given, and it tells us about how some of these people that were waterboarded, how they became so sick, and one man was just gurgling up foam and froth, and he was unconscious. He was basically drowned, and they revive him and bring him back. Sleep deprivation involving detainees awake for 180 hours, usually standing or in stress position at times with their hands shackled above their heads. At least 5 detainees experience disturbing hallucinations during prolonged sleep deprivation, and they think this is going to get the right information from them. And they're hallucinating so bad they don't even know the reality from the fiction. People put in containers that would be 21 and a half inches by 21 and a half inches by 2 feet. As one man said, he said, I get cramps just thinking of being in a situation like that, let alone being in it. And then they might put insects in it. you know, maybe cockroaches or bugs and stuff crawling all over the person. You can't get away from them, and they're just there. What was torture? Well, one of the definitions of torture, or parts of the definition of torture, again, is the action or practice of inflicting severe pain on someone as a punishment. Remember that. We're going to come back to that. But in our particular case, they're doing this to try to make them say something, to try to make them give information. And today we look upon this as a terrible scar to our nation and to what it has stood for. A terrible disrespect to the Stars and the Stripes. We expect under Castro in Cuba such torture as we read about in a story a few months back, where they confined this man in a very small area for sometimes weeks on end, and then they get them out, they can't even move their limbs, they're so stiff, you know. We expect that from Castro. Whereas in the story we've been reading this last week about Valdemar Jesk and how they would put him between the walls where he would have to stay in a standing position for long periods of time. We expect something like that from communist Russia. But not from America. But I want to ask you this. What if, and I'm just saying what if you were in charge and our nation was holding a terrorist prisoner who knew the location of a nuclear bomb somewhere in downtown New York City that was going to explode soon? And this person knows the location, refuses to tell. But if you can find that bomb, it can be deactivated. Now what are you going to do? What are you going to do? Are you going to maybe torture this one individual to get the information to save 10, 15, 20 million people's lives? What are you going to do? Will you approve of torture now? You see, friends, the decision might not be so easy as you think. We can blame our elected officials, and this was wrong. I believe it was wrong. But they may have felt under tremendous pressure to avoid another 9/11 situation. But friends, I want to tell you something. This kind of a decision will not be easy if you do not live by principles. But we have to live by principles, and the principle tells us that it's not the temporal life that's important, it's the eternal life that's important. And we're not to fear the one who can kill our body, but the one who can take our soul. Now to our question. Does God approve of torture? Because if he does, we are no better off than wicked man. And again, that definition of torture said the action or practice of inflicting severe pain on someone as punishment. But God says that he has ways, friends, that are different than the ways of humanity. In Isaiah 55, if you would turn with me there to the Old Testament book of Isaiah, it's just a little after the book of Psalms and Proverbs, those poetic books. Psalms 55 and verse 8. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. God's ways, friends, are far higher. Verse 9. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Friends, God does not seek death. God is the creator of all things, and he is the creator of life. And he loves life, and he wants life. Jesus said in John chapter 10, in verse 10, he says, I have come that they might have life, yes, and that they might have it more abundantly. God wants us to have an abundant life. And this is one of the reasons that the Bible speaks a lot about good health. Why it's important to have good health. God wants us to have an abundant life. He wants us to be happy, productive, good people. And it makes him happy to see this as well. He wants life so much, friends. Life so much that the Bible says he sent his only begotten Son to this earth to die for us. In fact, let's read that text. John chapter 3 and verse 16. We probably know it by heart, but let's read it again. Let's just notice exactly what the words say. John chapter 3 and verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Now this Bible verse speaks about a God of love, who understood and recognized clearly the depravity of man, the situation he was in, And he was going to be ruined. He was going to perish unless something happened. And that was, he would send his son who would die for us. And as we believe in Jesus, we may have everlasting life and not perish. We need not perish. It's interesting that if we look at this word in the original Greek that's translated perish, this is the root word for it, apolemi. It means to destroy utterly, to bring an end, to kill. The Strong's definition simply says to destroy fully, to destroy fully. This word, it means to annihilate or to eliminate, to perish. If something perishes, it doesn't exist anymore. Now, this word is also used in John 17. If we could turn John 17 and verse 12. Jesus says, "While I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name. Those that thou gavest me, I have kept, and none of them is lost, but the son of perdition, that the scripture might be fulfilled." Now, who was Jesus speaking about when he said the son of perdition here?
Satan.
Judas. All the disciples were going to be saved, but one. But he was the son of destruction, or the son of someone who's going to perish. But interestingly, the same language now is used in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. He says, "Let no man deceive you." I'm in verse 3. "Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come, except there come a falling away first, that the man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition." And of course, we realize this is speaking about the papacy, who's energized by Satan himself. But the son of destruction, the son of utter ruin. That's this concept that this word carries. And I think we can go to this next slide now. But this word, English word perdition, it comes from a Latin word which means to lose or to ruin. To lose or to ruin. Friends, I do not wish to perish. And I'm sure you don't either. There is a heaven to win, but there is a hell to shun. There is a hell to shun, and the only way is through Jesus Christ. In John chapter 14, John chapter 14 and verse 6, Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." I know Ashley knew that verse. We've been working on that in Sabbath school. John 14, 6. Jesus is the only way. Now, I'd like to propose to you today, there's probably more confusion on the doctrine of what we commonly call hell, or the fate of the wicked, than almost any other doctrine. Because this doctrine has been confused because the character of God has been maligned in it. God, in the common thinking of the doctrine of hell in nominal or the majority of Christianity, has become a torturer, the supreme torturer, the ultimate torturer, because he's going to take people who live on a very finite time of earth and put them through an infinitely long eternal hell. That is the common teaching. And in this hell, there will be flames and fire and just torture that is beyond description. Is God really, though, a torturous being who delights to punish sinners? That is our question today. Is he worse than Joseph Stalin? Is he worse than Adolf Hitler? You know, Hitler would take people and hang them with piano wire and other things. They approved the experimentation, medical experimentation of people. They took people and literally sewed their bodies together like Siamese twins. He did some terrible things. But you know what? At least Hitler let the people finally die and not have to be suffering forever and ever and ever. You know, if you've ever bought a jigsaw puzzle, and if you look at a jigsaw puzzle closely, especially the bigger ones with more pieces, you'll notice that they're cut out of specific patterns. And many times these pieces, the shape of a particular piece is duplicated throughout the set in various places. And so sometimes a piece may physically interlock in a particular place that doesn't fit. You know why? Because it doesn't make part of the big picture. It may seem to fit there. It may seem like it should go there, but it really doesn't fit the whole picture. And what we have in the Bible, friends, we have a picture of the character of God. And that overall picture is a very clear picture. It's a picture that says in 1 John chapter 4 and verse 8, and it's also repeated in verse 16 of the same chapter, that God is love. God is love. And friends, love is not manifested in eternally torturing someone. Even we as humanity have the sense of being. We as a country in the United States, we are in an uproar. Our people are concerned about this Senate intelligence report because we realize that this is inhumane. This is wrong. And yet somehow we can believe that the God of this universe, who's infinitely better, infinitely more loving, infinitely more wise than humanity, approves of eternal, endless torture. Friends, there are verses in the Bible that may seem to teach that at first glance. We'll look at some of them in a little bit. But they're like that little piece of the puzzle. They seem to fit and lock in right here, but when you put that up against the rest of the puzzle, the picture gets distorted. Because when you move that one piece out, you by necessity put the piece that should have been there somewhere else. You know, and even more of the puzzle now is distorted. More of the picture is distorted. In the book Great Controversy on page 535, one author wrote this: where in the pages of God's Word is such teaching to be found, referring to this doctrine of eternal torment? Will the redeemed in heaven be lost to all emotions of pity and compassion and even to feelings of common humanity? Are these to be exchanged for the indifference of the stoic or the cruelty of the savage? Think about that for a minute. Suppose you were in heaven and you know that maybe your child, your husband or wife who didn't get to heaven, is in a place, someplace, maybe you can't get exactly there, but you can sort of see it, you can sort of smell the smoke from it far off. And you know they're burning and withering in agony forever and ever and ever. And you think heaven's going to be a sweet, joyous place. It doesn't fit the big picture. The common picture of God, again, is one of a supreme being who can control all things, where might is right. And if you do not do it his way, he will torture you for an eternity for what you did during a finite period on this earth. No court in this country would agree to any such punishment, even for the most severest of crimes. You know, when you go into court and they sentence a person for an offense, they take into consideration the nature and the severity of the offense when they mete out the punishment. Now, it is true, friends, God's law is high and holy, and it certainly must be obeyed. And there certainly is just retribution for not obeying that law of God. But the Bible says in Romans chapter 6 and verse 23 that the wages of sin is eternal suffering. Yeah. Does it say that? Yeah. Well, let's look and see what it says. Romans 6, 23. For the wages of sin is death. It does not say eternal suffering. It does not say eternal torment or eternal torture. That's not what it says. We're going to come back to what it does say in just a few minutes. But we want to look at some basic questions about hell now. And the first basic question is when will hell occur? Because a lot of people have a misunderstanding of this. Some people say there's not going to be any hell. You know, sometimes Seventh-day Adventists are accused of saying there's no hell. But that's not what we believe at all. The Bible speaks about hell. And we're going to talk about this, what we're talking about right now. But there are some people think that hell's going on now, and some people think it's already past, some people think it's future. What does the Bible say about this? Let's turn some text in our Bible and find out. Let's go to Revelation chapter 20 first. Revelation chapter 20. And in Revelation chapter 20, we read about something called the millennium. And we don't have time to study the millennium this morning. But the millennium is an event that is bordered by the second and the third coming of Jesus Christ. The Bible says Jesus is coming back the second time without sin and salvation. And then he's going to take his people to heaven. There's going to be 1,000 years. The Bible calls it 1,000 years. Sometimes we use the term millennium. It's not a term found in the Bible, but it comes from a Latin term meaning 1,000 years. And That 1,000 years will begin when Jesus comes back the second time. But when the holy city descends and Jesus comes a third time, the 1,000 years will be over. In Revelation chapter 20, verse 7, it says, "And when the 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison." And then if we go to verse 11, he says, "And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire." So here's something the Bible describes indeed as a lake of fire. And friends, it's a hot lake. It's a very hot lake, and we'll discuss about just how hot it is in a little bit. But in Matthew chapter 13, Jesus told us something that gave us a very clear indication that this is indeed something that happens, not right now, but in the future, at the end of time, in fact. In Matthew 13, but notice in verse 40, it says, "As therefore the tares are gathered and burned in the fire, so shall it be when? In the end of the world. The Son of Man shall send forth his angels, and they shall gather out of his kingdom all things that offend and them that do which do iniquity, and shall cast them into a furnace of fire. There shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth." There is a hell, and it is a lake of fire, and there's going to be wailing and gnashing of teeth. It's not going to be pleasant, friends. But this is the means by which the death that Romans 6:23 speaks of is going to occur. But notice it happens at the end of the world. It's not happening right now. It's going to happen then to world at the end of that 1,000 years that we sometimes call millennium. In 2 Peter chapter 2 and verse 9, notice it says that the Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptations and to reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished. It says that the unjust or the wicked are reserved unto the day of punishment. In other words, friends, when we die, we don't go immediately to hell if we're wicked. We're reserved. The Bible speaks about death as a sleep, as an unconscious state of existence. Because the Bible says that the body minus the spirit is dead. And so there's no consciousness at that point. But that person that's wicked, that will finally find the lake of fire where there's wailing and gnashing of teeth, the Bible says that they are reserved, they're held in store until that time. And friends, I want to tell you one good thing, and that is the devil is not in control of hell. You know, I saw a picture one time, and it showed someone that was supposed to be like the devil, you know, the horns, the pitchfork, red skin, body. And it showed some people like in a furnace, and he was at the control panel and adjusting the heat up a little bit more, you know. Like the devil could control. And sometimes you hear these stories of people supposedly who had visions of hell. And we'll talk about that in a little bit. But how the idea is that the devil is there and his imps are there and they're taking pitchforks and prodding people and they're turning the heat up and they're pouring liquid molten fire through down these people's throats and we hear all these stories as if God is going to allow his arch enemy to be in control of the wicked. No. He's not going to let the devil have his jolly and glee for eternity torturing you. That's not going to happen. The truth is, friends, that there's nobody in the burning fires of hell today. This doesn't occur until the end of the world after the 1,000 years. Now, the next question might be then, where will hell be? We know when it's going to happen, but where will it be? And we can look in Isaiah chapter 24 and verse 21. It says, "And it shall come to pass in that day that the Lord shall punish the hosts of the high ones that are on high and the kings of the earth upon the earth." Where? Upon the earth. That's what it says right here in Proverbs 11, verse 31. It says, "Behold, the righteous shall be recompensed in the earth." But notice what else it says. It says, "Much more the wicked and the sinner." Much more. Much more what? The wicked and the sinner are going to be recompensed in the earth or on this earth. That's where they will find their final retribution. 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 10. The Bible says, "But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night. in the which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat, the earth also and the works that are therein shall be what? Burned up. He tells us here in 2 Peter 3:10, he tells us that this earth is going to be burned up. There's a day when this earth is going to be burned up. And that's one reason why the Bible says that God's going to make a new heaven and a new earth. At the end of that millennium, at the end of that 1,000 years, this earth and those who are wicked will be burned up with it. And it's right after that, in chapter 21 of Revelation, that the Bible says that God makes a new heaven and a new earth. Also here in verse 7, it says, but the heavens and the earth, which are now, by the same word, are kept in store, reserved unto fire against the day of judgment and perdition of ungodly men. There's that word perdition again, the destruction. The final destruction, total eradication of ungodly men. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 20, going back to that chapter, Revelation chapter 20 and verse 9, that the wicked, says they went upon the breadth of the earth. This is the they, as you refer back to it, is going back the antecedents to the wicked. It says they went upon the breadth of the earth and compassed the camp of the saints about the beloved city, and fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. Says this fire is so hot it devours. Yes, there will be some wailing and gnashing teeth, but I don't think it's going to happen very long, and we'll talk about that in just a minute too. But God says he's going to make a new heaven and a new earth in verse 1 of chapter 21 of Revelation. I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And he sees the holy city descend. He says in verse 4, God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. There will be tears. The context is just after the destruction of the wicked. There'll be people that we knew that won't be anymore. But somehow, friends, God's going to have a way of taking that heartache away. In Peter, he says the earth will be burned up. But now we read about new heaven and new earth. And this should give us an understanding of just how long hell will last. It's not something that goes on forever and ever. It has a finite time. We don't know how long it is, but it can't be very long. An eternally burning hell, though, very frankly, is another of the false doctrines from the cup of Babylonian wine. Remember John 3:16, the Bible says that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth him should not perish, but have what? Everlasting life. We don't need to perish. This is called the most beloved, most favorite Bible text of all time, and yet I believe, friends, it's the most unbelieved Bible text there is. Do you know that? It really is the most unbelieved text of all the Bible. Because there's two specific things it speaks about that nominal common Christianity denies. One is that the wicked will perish. It says the wicked will perish. But no common Christianity says the wicked don't perish. The wicked live on forever in a torturous situation in hell. Now friends, you can say that's not life. You can say that all you want. But you know, if I look out in the field, I grew up in country and a lot of farming country. And if I saw a cow or something that looked like a cow in the next field, and it ate grass like a cow, and it made the sounds like a cow, and it smelled like a cow, you know what it was? It was a cow. We can say, friends, we can say that eternal torture is not life. But friends, it's miserable life. It's bad life, but it's still life. It's still living. And we either perish or we don't. And the second point about this text, the Bible says that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. And yet, common Christianity today denies that Jesus is the real Son of God. They say he's really the second person of the Trinity who only assumes the role of a son. He's not really the Son of God at all. But you see, when we put those two false ideas together, that Jesus isn't the Son of God, and that the wicked really don't perish but burn forever, it slanders God's character. It changes our God from a God of love who loved us so much he gave his only begotten Son for us to a God who didn't really give anything for us and is going to torture those who disagree with him. And so this is a big doctrine because the character of God is involved. We will never be able to properly see the whole picture if we don't get all these pieces of the theological puzzle put into place in the right positions. We are given a choice, as we read earlier in Romans chapter 6 and verse 23, that the wages of sin is death. But contrary to that, set in contradistinction to that. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. So we can have eternal life through Christ, but only through Christ and no other way. In 1 John chapter 2, starting in verse 15, the Bible says, "Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, and the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world." And now notice verse 17, it's the kicker here. "And the world passes away, and the lust thereof, but he that doeth the will of God abideth forever." Do you see the distinction here? We can either pass away or we can abide forever. But if you believe in an eternal burning hell, that means that I still live forever. I just live forever in a bad way. But that's not the picture of the Bible. In 1 John chapter 3, verse 15, it says, "Whosoever hateth his brother is a murderer, and ye know that no murderer hath," what? "Eternal life abiding in him." Not at all. And in 1 John chapter 5, while we're in this wonderful book, 1 John chapter 5, verse 12, "He that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life." Could we make it any clearer? I can't make it any clearer. The Bible makes it clear. It's very plain. Now I'll ask you a question. Let's go back to the book of Genesis. A good place to go for a study. Let's go back to the book of Genesis. And while you're going back to the book of Genesis, chapter 3 particularly, I'm going to ask you a question. Adam and Eve were created perfect, weren't they? And they were given a perfect home to live in. It was called the Garden of what?
Eden.
But something happened, and they had to leave that garden home. Remember, they took the fruit they weren't supposed to, and they had to leave that garden home. But the question is, why? But you know what? Adam and Eve did do something wrong, and they had to leave. But there was a consequence, friends, in their leaving. And it wasn't just simply as a punishment, but because of a cause and effect that they had to leave. And in Genesis chapter 3, verse 22, notice what God says. "And the Lord God said, Behold, the man has become as one of us to know good and evil. And now, lest he put forth his hand and take also the tree of life and eat and live forever, therefore the Lord God sent him forth from the Garden of Eden to till the ground from whence he was taken." He says, you can no longer stay in this garden because in this garden is the tree of life. It's nowhere else. And you must leave this garden. And you'll never eat of this tree again while you're on this earth. And if I let you do that, you'll live forever. Even in his sinful state, there was something about this fruit that could have enabled him to live forever. And God says, I'm not going to have an immortal sinner. It's not going to happen. Now, what about the fate of the wicked? If they really don't have eternal life, what happens? Well, there's something that's said in Isaiah, and we should turn there, in Isaiah 28, because earlier we read in Isaiah 55 that God's ways are not our ways, his thoughts are not our thoughts, and that's for certainly true. But in Isaiah chapter 28 and verse 21, it says, "For the Lord shall rise up as in Mount Perazim, he shall be wroth as in the valley of Gibeon, that he may do his work, his strange act, and bring to pass his act, his strange act." The destruction of the wicked, friends, is called a strange act. A strange act. And it's strange because it seems so out of character to a God of love and God of justice. Why would God bring the destruction of the wicked? Surely, if he's a God of love, why can't he just let everyone go to heaven? And there are people who believe that. They believe that God is such a God of love that he's just going to put everybody in heaven. But you know, I have this opportunity every now and then to go and speak to people that aren't church folks. You may too at times. And they might be the people who are the beer-drinking, drug-taking crowd, the people who are carousers, people who are fighters and stuff like that. And especially if they don't have an inclination toward repentance, if they don't have a heart toward the things of God, and you talk to that person and say, you know, I think you ought to come to church next Sabbath. No, I don't want to go to church. And you know, if you were to tell that person, well, I'm going to force you to go to church, what would happen? They'd be ready to fight, wouldn't they? That's the last place they want to be. Sinners don't want to be around righteous people, friends. And they don't want to be around a righteous God. And it would be absolutely torture to take a wicked person and put them among the saints and the holy atmosphere of heaven. It wouldn't stay holy very long. It'd be all messed up again. And God's not going to do that. And you know, even we as humanity, I faced a terrible decision earlier this year. In a bit of haste, I got in my automobile, and without watching carefully, I ran over my cat. Ran over her, and hit her backside and part of her midsection. And she had a very bad fractured leg. And she was ruptured and hurt internally as well. And I had a choice of trying to do something or to put her down. We use this expression, put her down. And sometimes we have to put an animal down. We think we have to put an animal down because we don't want it to what?
Suffer.
We feel like that there comes a point when it's better to take the life of that animal than to let it suffer. And we call this a humane treatment. We say we're treating it humanely to do this. And I think everyone agrees with that concept. There's very few people that would question that is, quote, the humane thing to do at certain times. Fortunately, my cat, due to the encouragement of Brother Leon, decided to give it a little time. And then as I was watching it, I thought, I can't watch this thing suffer. It's suffering. I got to take it to the vet. He said, maybe it'll get better, you know. And then you can take it to the vet if you think it's going to live. And I thought, I can't do this. I got to take it to the vet anyhow. And I took it to the vet. And sure enough, she recovered. And she had to have a leg amputated. But she's actually over in the office right now in her bed, just doing pretty good. But we think of this as humane. Now, I want you to think about God for a minute. Here he has a class of humanity called sinners. Wicked people who do not want to change. They are so set in sin, they will never change again. They are so wicked that they have tried to kill all the saints, especially those living at the end time. They are so wicked that even when God brings the plagues, the Bible says that they blaspheme God because of these plagues. These are people who won't change anymore. And God could perpetuate their life. But you see, friends, his law would be compromised for one thing. It's because the wages of sin is death. And the Bible tells us that sin is the transgression of God's law. But God does the best thing he can do, friends. He allows justice to happen, yes. But he allows justice to finish. And he puts the wicked people out of their misery, as it were. I'm not afraid to say it like that at all. The wicked are in misery today. Some of them don't realize it. You know, the pleasures of sin are for a season. But I want to tell you, throughout eternity, sin and wickedness is a terrible existence. And God's not going to allow it to be perpetuated forever. In Psalms 37, if we could turn to Psalms 37. I mean, this is the logical doctrine of the Bible, but it is the clear doctrine of the Bible, clear doctrine of the Word as well as a logical doctrine. In Psalms 37 and verse 10, it says, "For yet a little while the wicked shall not be, yea, thou shalt diligently consider his place, and it shall not be." Won't even be in an everlasting, eternally burning hell. No, it shall not be. There's coming an end to all this. In verse 20, it says, "But the wicked shall perish, and the enemies of the Lord shall be as the fat of lambs. They shall consume in the smoke, shall they consume away." In Psalms 59, in verse 13, it says, "Consume them in wrath, consume them, that they may not be." And this is the fate of the wicked. As we read in Revelation 20, verse 9 earlier, that the fire comes down from God out of heaven and devours them or consumes them. And friends, it's just not going to be the wicked people on this earth. It's going to be Satan and his angels as well. And even Satan and his destruction is foretold in the book of Ezekiel. Turn with me to Ezekiel chapter 28. Ezekiel chapter 28. Now in the 28th chapter of Ezekiel, God speaks of Satan under the symbol of the prince of Tyre. But there can be no question as you read the context that it's speaking about Satan. It speaks in verse 13 about how he had been in Eden and so forth. But in verse 18, notice what it says. "Thou hast defied thy sanctuaries by the multitude of thy iniquities, by the iniquity of thy traffic. Therefore, I will bring forth a fire from the midst of thee. It shall devour thee, and I will bring thee to ashes upon the earth in the sight of all them that behold thee. All they that know thee among the people shall be astonished at thee. Thou shalt be a terror, and never shalt thou be any more." says that Satan will be brought to ashes. Where at? On this earth. Isn't that what we read elsewhere in the Bible? And the Bible's consistent in this. It's very clear in this. And even Satan will be brought to ashes and says that he will never more be. Dr. Adam Clark, a famous Methodist theologian, said this about the wicked. It says, recording from Malachi chapter 4 and verse 1, you know the text in Malachi chapter 4 verse 1, says it shall leave them neither root nor branch. He says that this is a proverbial expression for total destruction. For total destruction. Where in the pages of the Bible is such a teaching that God is an eternal torturer and tormentor? Will we lose all of our feelings of emotions and pity through heaven and eternity if this is something that is real and going on? I don't think so. I don't think we're going to exchange feelings of compassion and pity for indifference, for the stoic side of the cruelty of the savage. This isn't going to happen at all. Now, in Matthew chapter 10, we have a little more clarification on some points here we want to look at. About this destruction, because some people say, well, you know, the body may be destroyed, but the spirit will live on and be in torture. But let's notice something that Jesus says about this in Matthew chapter 10, because we don't want to be confused. Remember earlier we said it took a body and a spirit both to make a living soul. So here we have in Matthew chapter 10, verse 28, Jesus saying, "And fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear him which is able to destroy both soul and body in hell." In other words, the wicked person in their totality will be destroyed in hell. That's what the Bible says. In Matthew chapter 7 and verse 13, notice Jesus says, "Enter ye in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to what?" That leadeth to what? To destruction. "And many there be which go in thereat. Because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto what? Life. And few there be that find it." We can either have life, or we can have destruction. You won't have both. You can have one or the other. The devil, friends, hates this truth about God because it reveals God as a just God, not as a cruel tyrant who would burn people forever and ever for a short life upon this earth. Now, I want to discuss some things that might be considered as objections to this or perhaps other viewpoints. People maybe who have taken that piece of the puzzle, and even though it locks in perfectly into a particular position, it doesn't really show the whole picture, but they're not standing back enough to see the whole picture, or they don't have the box, you know, the picture on the box, to know what the puzzle is supposed to look like. And so because of preconceived ideas, they say, well, this text seems to fit here. It must be a part of the overall picture of the Bible. And so how do we relate to certain things? You might be wondering, as we mentioned earlier, about people, for instance, who've had visions or maybe these so-called near-death experiences, maybe being taken to hell and seeing what was going on in hell right now, but then they're brought back for one more chance, you know, so they don't have to go. But I want to tell you a story, it's actually not my story, but Dr. John McDougall, some of you have heard of Dr. McDougall, he was telling a story one day about arguing with Dr. John Scharfenberg about a particular point of medical research. And Dr. McDougall freely said that this happened years ago when he was younger and thought he knew everything. And they were talking about a particular medical point, and he was citing medical research. The medical research says, and Dr. Scharfenberg said to this, he says that the medical research doesn't matter. "Well, what do you mean?" asked McDougall. And he replied, "It's in the Bible." And that, friends, really is the bottom line. It doesn't matter what the medical research says. If the Bible says something different, this was the point McDougall was making, it doesn't matter. You know, people quote sometimes certain parts of medical research, he says, but the problem is we don't have the whole picture very well. We study one particular thing, like maybe the idea of glycemic index. And as an example, he said, you know, they talk about how bad it is if a particular food has a high glycemic index, right? And did you know that fructose has the actual lowest of all glycemic indexes down at about 20. White sugar is 100. And a potato is like 120. Well, which one's best to eat? The potato. You know, and so sometimes we look at one piece of information, we don't get the whole picture very well. It doesn't always necessarily tell us what the whole picture of something is. And McDougall was bringing up the point. He says, you know, he says, if the Bible, he says, and the Bible is one of our sources of truth on nutrition. If the Bible says this, then everything else is wrong if it says something contrary to it. And so I would say this about people who claim to have had visions, people who have claimed to have had near-death experiences. Friends, if it doesn't match with what the Bible says, it's not true.
Amen.
People may be delusioned. People may have had hallucinations. People may really believe this. But it doesn't matter what you believe. It doesn't matter what dream or vision or hallucination you've had. If it doesn't match up to the Word of God, it is not truth at all. And we can't go by it. Now, what about the idea that the Bible speaks about eternal fire? And you know what? The Bible does speak about that. So we should understand what it means. But let's go to the end of our Bible, just a little actually pass from the end to the book of Jude. It's the first book before Revelation. Revelation is the last book of the Bible. And there's a little epistle that just has one chapter. It's called the book of Jude that comes before that. And let's see what it says here. And so it's chapter 1 because there is only one chapter. But we'll read verse 7. It says here, even as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities about them in like manner, giving themselves over to fornication and going after strange flesh, are set forth for an example, suffering the vengeance of what? Eternal fire. Does the Bible say eternal fire? It sure does. But the question is, what does it mean? You say, well, it's self-evident. We know what it means. Maybe we don't. We need to let the Bible interpret itself. But notice it says that Sodom and Gomorrah have suffered the vengeance of eternal fire. And not only them, but the cities about them as well. Now turn with me to the book of 2 Peter chapter 2 and verse 6. Notice that Peter says, turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes, condemn them with an overthrow, making them an example or ensample unto those that after should live ungodly. He says that Sodom and Gomorrah were turned to ashes. And we know the Bible says that God brought fire and brimstone upon Sodom and Gomorrah. These were wicked cities, and they were polluting all the nations and populations around them. And the only way to check this terrible sin, which is so acceptable in our society today, the only way to check it was to destroy it at that time. If God hadn't destroyed it, it would have ruined many, many more people. And God in His mercy brought fire and brimstone. But it brought them to ashes. And in fact, to the best we understand, the location of those cities today is at the bottom of what we call the Dead Sea, underwater. They were brought to ashes underwater. But Jude says that they were suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. Now we know they're not burning today. But those cities, friends, are an example. He says here that they are an example. An example to those that after should live ungodly. And so what happened to them will be an example to those who live afterwards. The fire is eternal because the effects are eternal. The fire has done its work, and it can, and that which was burnt will never be viable or live again. In Matthew chapter 25, we have a text that sometimes has been a little disturbing to people. Matthew chapter 25 and verse 46. Jesus spoke about the sheep and the goats, remember? And some get life and some don't. But notice what he says. And these, the goats, shall go into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into life eternal. And that sure sounds like an eternal burning hell. They shall go into everlasting punishment. But notice that the text says punishment, not punishing. The text says punishment, not punishing, because this punishment has an eternal effect upon them. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, in verse 9, speaking about Jesus, it says, in flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God and that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's verse 8. And then in verse 9, it says, who shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of our Lord and from the glory of His power. And so this destruction has an everlasting effect. But there's no way, friends, we can take these texts and try to make them say something other than what the big picture, the way the evidence of the Bible is showing. It's true, if we just took one or two texts without really reading them carefully, and out of their context, we might be led to believe many different things about the Bible. And in fact, That's one of the reasons that we have so many different hundreds and thousands of different Christian denominations today, because people don't carefully study and read all the Bible. And they take just a text here or a text there, but we have to look at all the Bible texts and make them reconcile one with another. Now, there's a text that we bypassed in Revelation 10 or Revelation chapter 20 earlier, and I want to go back to it now, because maybe you thought that I was avoiding that text, but I wasn't. So let's go back to Revelation chapter 20, but I think we'll be able to understand it a lot better now. Revelation chapter 20, and we'll read verse 9 again, and then verse 10. It says, "And they went up on the breadth of the earth," this is the wicked, "and compassed the camp of the saints about, and the beloved city, and fire came down from God out of heaven," and what? Devoured them. But now notice what else it says as a complementary parallel idea to this. "And the devil that deceiveth them," adding the detail here, "was cast in the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night." How long? Forever and ever. But then we read in Ezekiel chapter 28 and verse 19 that Satan would be brought to ashes upon the earth. Didn't we read that cities of Sodom and Gomorrah were brought to ashes, and they're an example of those who live ungodly? So how do we reconcile this also with verse 9 that says they'll be devoured? We need to understand that in the Bible, in the way God uses His Word, that the expression forever, and even forever and ever, has a relative meaning. Sometimes it can mean eternity in the common sense of the language. That's what heaven will be, without any question. But sometimes this word can have a relative meaning. I want to show you from the Bible, not from my own ideas, not from someone else's non-biblical dictionary, but from the Bible itself, how this is true. First Chronicles. Chronicles comes a little after Samuel. You have Samuel, 1st, 2nd Samuel, 1st and 2nd Kings, 1st and 2nd Chronicles. 1st Chronicles chapter 28. 1st Chronicles chapter 28 and verse 4. This was David speaking here. David came before the people and says, "Howbeit the Lord God of Israel chose me before all the house of my father to be king over Israel." For how long? Forever. I thought David was king for about 40 years altogether. No. It says he was to be king forever. But of course, David isn't the king of Israel today, is he? But it was to be for as long as he lived. As long as he lived. Another interesting text is in the book of Exodus. What's in the 20th chapter of Exodus? The Ten Commandments. But let's go to the chapter just after that. Exodus chapter 21. Exodus chapter 21. And there were certain judgments and rules and regulations for how the children of Israel were to live. And at that time, there was something that they called slavery that existed. And slavery then wasn't really the same kind of slavery we think of today, but it was actually a type of economic indenturement or servitude due to economic reasons. The person would become in debt and they might sell their services to someone and be as a slave in that sense. But there was a provision made for those slaves, and that is every seventh year they were to be set free. If a man was a slave, he could only work so long and then he'd be set free. But it says here in verse 2, he says, "If thou buy a Hebrew servant, 6 years he shall serve thee, and in the seventh he shall go out free for nothing. If he came in by himself, he shall go out by himself. If he were married, then his wife shall go out with him." Verse 4. "If his master hath given him a wife, and she hath borne him sons or daughters, the wife and her children shall be her master's, and he shall go out by himself." In other words, they'd have to wait for a while. Maybe their seventh year didn't come on the same time his did. But it says in verse 5, "And if thy servant shall plainly say, I love my master, my wife, and my children, and I will not go out free, then his master shall bring him unto the judges. He shall also bring him to the door, or into the door post, and his master shall bore his ear through with an awl, and he shall serve him forever." In other words, they were to take something that looked like an ice pick. It's a tool called an awl. It's a very sharp pointed instrument. And they were to put his ear up against that doorpost, and they would push this through. We used to do this all the time. Today we call it ear piercing. You know, that's what they did. But they didn't put a ring in it, but it was simply to be a symbol that this man was going to serve this master. He wasn't going to leave him. And how long was he going to serve him? Forever. But friends, are there going to be people serving God? I'm sorry, slaves. Are there going to be slaves serving people in heaven? Obviously not. In In other words, it was simply for as long as this man lived, he was going to be that servant. And so this expression we see here in the Bible, it has a rich meaning. It has a varied meaning. And I can just give you a couple more references. One is in the book of Jonah. In Jonah 1:17, Jonah says, I was in the belly of the whale for how long? Actually, he says fish. Jesus called it a whale later. But for how long?
Forever.
Well, in verse 17, it says for 3 days and nights. But then in chapter 2 and verse 6, he says, I was there forever. And so he uses a very small term. Now, it might seem like forever to him, you know, at that time. One more thing, and I just will mention this briefly because we're running out of time. But a lot of people are concerned about the 16th chapter of Luke. Because in the 16th chapter of Luke, there's a story or parable Jesus taught about a rich man and about Lazarus. Remember that story? And we don't have time to read the whole story, but if you're familiar with it, and I think you are, then you'll understand what we're going to say about it. But either this story, the rich man and Lazarus, is literally true, or it's a parable trying to teach a lesson. And I'd like to propose at least four reasons, briefly, why it cannot possibly be a literal teaching, but rather symbolic of things. And the first is that the Bible says in this story, Jesus says that the beggar died, and he was taken by the angels to Abraham's bosom. To Abraham's bosom. Now, I have never found anyone yet who believes that Abraham's bosom is the literal abode of the righteous. Or the dead, for that matter. It is figuratively or a parabolic expression. And incidentally, the Bible says that the angels will gather the saints, but according to Matthew 24, verses 30 and 31, this will take place at the coming of Jesus, though, and not at a person's death. Second point, that in this parable, heaven and hell were separated by a great gulf, and yet the persons could converse with each other. And I don't know of anyone who literally believes that that's going to happen. The people are literally going to be talking back and forth between heaven and hell. The third point, the rich man was in hell with a body. And almost no one believes that you take your body to hell. It's your spirit that goes there. But he had eyes, a tongue, etc. How did he get into the hellfire instead of into the grave? I don't know of anyone who teaches that the bodies of the wicked go to hell as soon as they die. And so this story could not literally be true. And the fourth is simply this. The request of Lazarus to have this, to have the request of the rich man to have Lazarus to take his finger and to dip it in some water and bring it and touch his tongue. And what good is that going to do? By the time he gets to that great gulf, the water's evaporated out. I mean, it's so unrealistic that could happen. But it is symbolic of something. There's no question about that. And this rich man undoubtedly represented the Jews in this parable because only the Jews would pray to Father Abraham. The beggar represented the Gentiles, those who were counted unworthy to receive the truth. In fact, in Matthew chapter 15, verse 27, the Canaanite woman acknowledged that her people were beggars at the tables of the Jews. And Christ probably chose the name Lazarus to use in this parable because he would actually raise a man by the name of Lazarus from the dead. And the climatic point of the whole parable, if you want to look at it, is found in Luke 16:31. We should read that point. Because remember that when you interpret a parable, one of the most important rules of interpreting a parable is that parables are designed to teach one basic truth. You can't just exegete every individual item of a parable, make something literal out of it, because sometimes symbolic things are used to teach a main focal point. And that main focal point is found here in Luke 16, verse 31. And Jesus said unto him, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded though one rose from the dead. That is the main point. If we don't hear the prophets, the word of God given to us, then if someone raises from the dead, we won't believe that either. We won't believe, in other words, signs and wonders aren't enough, friends. We have to believe the word of God. And they didn't hear Moses and the prophets. And in fact, when Jesus raised one whose name was Lazarus from the dead, they didn't hear him either, did they? And so the point was true. I'd like to just share with you as we begin to close here a statement from the book Great Controversy again. And I think this is so well said, so I've put it here on the screen for us. What would be gained to God should we admit that he delights in witnessing unceasing tortures, that he is regaled with the moans and shrieks and imprecations of the suffering creatures whom he holds in the flames of hell? Can these horrid sounds be music in the ears of infinite love? It is urged that the infliction of endless misery upon the wicked would show God's hatred of sin as an evil which is ruinous to the peace and order of the universe. O dreadful blasphemy! as if God's hatred of sin is the reason why it is perpetuated. For according to the teachings of these theologians, continued torture without hope of mercy maddens its wretched victims, and as they pour out their raging curses and blasphemy, they are forever augmenting their load of guilt. God's glory is not enhanced by thus perpetuating continual increasing sin through ceaseless ages. Beloved, soon this universe will be clean and sin will not ever happen again. Nahum 1:9 promises that. He says affliction will be over and that it will never arise a second time. God has made provisions by John 3:16 that we might have eternal life. Let us not neglect that call. In fact, there's a question in Hebrews chapter 2. We want to look at this question just for a moment. Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 3. It says, how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation? And of course, the implied answer is, friends, we will not escape. We have a great salvation offered to us. Hell, the Bible says, Jesus says that hell was prepared for the devil and his angels in Matthew 25:41. It wasn't prepared for people. But we must be ready today to accept Jesus. You can trust in him. You can trust his Father. They are not terrorists. They are not the supreme torturers of the universe. In fact, it will be proven in Revelation chapter 15. And what is sung in verse 3 to be so true. And they sing the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb, saying, great and marvelous are thy works, Lord God Almighty. Just and true are thy ways, thou King of saints. Friends, God is not a sadist. God isn't a torturer. He doesn't approve of torture at all. He believes in justice. He believes in mercy. And the Bible says that righteousness and peace met and kissed on the cross. Through the cross, we have that opportunity for have eternal life. It comes by faith in believing in Jesus. And that belief, friends, does something for us. It motivates us to live a holy life for him so that we don't have to have eternal loss, so that we don't have to perish, but that we can have the gift of God, which is eternal life. May God bless each one of you lots and lots. It's my prayer that you will accept Jesus as your personal Savior today, Kevin, today. And to each one who's not made that decision, we need to do that today.